Yo! Some longer time has passed since the last video upload, but today the time has come to learn something new and understand how to apply scaling to our movable widgets. This will be a little bit more advanced video from the setup as well from the math side, but I'll try to explain it as good as possible, so let's get started. We're gonna use the old project from the previous video so we can have the movable widgets ready to use. And please note that the scaling setup is designed for movable widgets here, and for the static parts, the math and wall setup will be different. In this video, I'll show you three different options of scaling: horizontal, vertical, and from the corner. To begin, let's actually see how we can rescale all of those stuff. If we rescale our canvas, the part seems to stay still. There's something called scale box, but this is not the case. The issue here is that the anchors of those parts that are attached to the canvas are set to be at the top left corner, so only if we move the widget, they will keep their location there. So if we change the anchor of the background image to full size, it will already rescale together with the canvas. The anchors will tell the part how it should take its space in the parent, therefore it's very important to set them correctly. Let's also change the anchor of the top bar, and as you can see, there are many different options to choose from, so let's select the one that looks pretty like our top bar itself. Now as we rescale the canvas, the top bar will always stretch to the horizontal size at the top, and the background image will always take the full size of canvas, minus 40 units from the top side. And do you know what that means? We can again simply change the size of the canvas and all the parts will behave as we just want them to. Truly amazing, isn't it? To add something interesting to it, let's grab some text block to display the final size of the window. Here we will specify the anchors at the bottom right edge, and let's play around with the alignment. We need to set it up at least to one unit on both X and Y, so it's gonna stay inside of our window. And select fit to size, so if the text changes, the wrapper box will rescale as well. We need that because if the text goes longer, it may exceed the size of our window, and this is very likely to happen. The next thing to do are three new buttons to rescale our window. One of them is gonna be on the right side. Now select appropriate anchor, fit the scaling and position, and set X alignment to 1 so it goes inside. Similar thing to the next button, which will go to the bottom of the window. Select anchor, fit the scaling and position, and here the X alignment will remain 0 and Y set to 1. Easy, right? The last button is gonna be a little 10x10 square placed in the bottom right edge. So again, anchor, scaling and position, and both X and Y alignment set to 0.5, so it's gonna be in the middle. That looks already good. Now it's time to start some coding. First of all, let's create events for all buttons. We need the onPressed and onReleased events, as we will again need a timer that can be used to update the scale. Once we have them, let's also create the timer itself. We want to use only one timer to update all scales, so we need some system that will let our timer know which type of scaling math should it perform. What would you use? There are many different possibilities to achieve the same result. For example, an integer, and depending on the value, it will respond with different code, but we have something more convenient to use. Let's head to the content browser. Right-click on it, hover over the blueprints, and select Enumerator. It is a list of names that you create on your own. Let's give it a name, and inside of it, add three entries, which we'll call accordingly to our scaling methods. Once ready, let's save and go back to our window blueprint. Here, let's add a new variable, give it a proper name, and we need to change its type. And the type of blueprint is the enumerator we just created, so let's try to find it. What we need now is to set the value whenever click on a specific button is recognized to store the information about actual scaling method we're gonna apply. We'll use that only when we click the button. We don't need it on release because we are no more scaling the window. Now we can use the same enumerator by the timer and create a switch so every case has its own behavior. So, if you still lost, Enumerator is just a list of any name you put there, and in the blueprints you can set which name is now in use, change the actual name in use, or get the actual name in use. That gives you the opportunity to make different scenarios for different names, as you can use only one name at a time, and for example determine if you hold an item in your left or right hand. But let's head back to the blueprints. Before we can even do the scaling, regardless of the method, we always need to update the mouse position, so this part will happen at the very beginning. And by the click events, we need to calculate the mouse position differential before the timer starts ticking. We need that to prevent instant movement on click without actually moving the mouse. It's the same thing we did to prevent moving the window to mouse at 0-0 location in the previous video. And now, prepare for madness. This time, if you'll use only the canvas position, it's gonna return as way too big values for rescaling. We can check that by creating a simple debug string. And as you can see, this returns as a very large value, which will not help us too much. We also need the actual size of the window and add it to that position. Now, if we click on the button, it will display the proper value, which is the location difference between mouse click location and button's middle point, or else the edge of the window. As the click differential is calculated using canvas information and not the specific button we click, we can select all responsible nodes and collapse to a macro, which we can reuse as a very nice and small node in the other events. You are probably a bit confused right now, and so was I when I was creating this for my first time, so let me explain how I worked this out. As mentioned a few moments ago, we need to add two 2D position values, which are the window location and window size. If we do so, we get the position of the bottom right corner of our window, where we have the button to rescale X and Y size. We are also using a node called getMousePositionInViewport, so if we move our mouse to the window's bottom right corner, we'll get the same value as the corner position. The rescale button is 10 times 10 units big, and its middle point is exactly at the same spot where the window's corner. So if we click on it with our mouse, we need the difference value to prevent instant rescale to the actual mouse location. Now a little fun fact I realized right now. If you are following this video and recreate the stuff with me, you can skip the button's position update part and do the only rescaling math, because button's placement is affected by the anchors, therefore they will always keep the right placement. And that piece of code is just unnecessary. We still need the position difference calculation by the onPressed events, but we don't need to move the buttons at all. But if you want, you can do this part as well, as it will simply move the buttons to their correct locations based on our math, but it's totally unnecessary. But I'll explain it anyway, as it's a part of the recording anyway, and you will understand the math alignment better. And bugs and mistakes are totally normal in our creations, so don't hate me for that one. So, let's begin with the corner scaling, as it's gonna be the easiest setup, and the other two will be pretty based on that one. First, let's subtract the click location difference from the mouse location, and yes, I know you see a plus, and I said we'd subtract the value, that's because I messed it up, and fix it later. It should be a minus here, and with the wrong code, the button was moving to the opposite side instead of staying in place. So, keep in mind. From the first subtraction, we will again subtract another 2D struct. Let's drop our macro and expand what it signed. We need the part where we add the window position and the size, and this is what we need to subtract. All those nodes together are already the final position of the button. Additionally, let's make the button go back to its original place whenever we release the mouse button. And look, what a coincidence! I got a nice comment from Lawrence Desmet regarding the previous part about widgets while working on the next part. Wow, that was really cool! Thank you for your words, and I am glad you like the stuff I provide. A giant beer mug for ya, bro! Also, don't forget to check the About section of my channel to find a link to my Discord. So as you can see now, the button goes back to its local 0-0 location, which is so much fun. Now it's time to create what interests you at most, the scaling. From the blueprint side, it's gonna be very easy to create, but not so easy to understand, so let's see what I am about to do here. We already have the calculation of the final location of the button. We can use this code to calculate the final size as well. We simply add the result to the actual window size. And now, when we click and move the mouse, the size will change depending on the mouse position, so what exactly happens here? From the mouse location, we subtract the click distance difference, which is saved whenever we click on a button. From that calculation, we subtract the final position value of the corner to get a value of 0, so when we click, nothing will happen until we move the mouse. Now we add this value to the actual window size. So basically, we needed that part to end up with 0 until we move the mouse, and that will move the final X and Y floats. Let's move on to the other two scaling methods. Let's move this piece of code to the side and start with the next one. We're gonna skip moving the button part as it works even without this happening, and we will focus on the scaling math itself. The next one is the vertical scaling, so basically the only thing to change here is to split the 2D struct, set the Y value to our previous calculation, and keep the X value as it is by getting the information straight out from the window size. By testing, I encountered a little issue, but it was very simple to find as it was just a wrong reference. I just thought to get info straight out of the window and I have a button reference connected, which led to wrong calculations. Now as it's fixed, it should work just fine. Oh yeah, that really satisfies me. And finally, the last scaling method. This is gonna be even easier as we simply need to swap X and Y values to switch from vertical to horizontal scaling. And that's it. We're done with scaling the widget system. And as I mentioned about the button movement part, that's unnecessary. If we skip that part completely, it will still behave exactly the same. But I realized that after the recording, so I included the setup as well. So, now it's time for some conclusion, right? As our mouse location is calculated from the top left corner of the viewport and the scaling should relate to it, we had to create a calculation that will tell us a value of 0 when we click on a button and affect the size whenever we move the mouse. Additionally, when we click on a button, the mouse isn't exactly where the corner of the window is. Therefore, we needed this differential value. Combining the values together, we got the value that interests us, and when we move the mouse around, the size will be adapted based on the mouse movement. I hope that you made some notes or drawn some nice sketches. Thanks for attention and for your patience. Peace!